Welcome to Gracefully Greying. I'm your host, Attorney Henry Gornbein. Every week on Gracefully Greying, we cover topics that impact upon those of us who are 50 and over or with aging parents. Today on Gracefully Greying, I am pleased to welcome as my guest, Dottie Deremo, as we discuss the topic of happily failing at retirement. Dottie, welcome.
Thank you, Henry. It's a pleasure to be on the program.
First of all, why don't you tell our viewers a little bit about who you are and your background?
Well, I have failed retirement, and I have my own business called the Deremo Group. It's a consulting business that I work with boards, CEOs, and C-suites on business and talent strategies. So I do strategic planning, succession planning, business renewal, business sustainability, and then I work on issues around leadership and teamwork, really at the highest level in most companies, both in the for-profit and the not-for-profit sector. Prior to that, I was the CEO of Hospice of Michigan for 15 years, and prior to that, I was an executive at Henry Ford Health System for 11 years and the Detroit Medical Center for 10 years, and prior to that I was a nurse practitioner, and prior to that I still am a registered nurse. This is my 50th year as a registered nurse. So I've had a long and checkered past and started out really as a nurse aide and became a registered nurse and got into healthcare administration and became a CEO and failed retirement, and now I have my own business.
Well, how did you fail retirement? Because it sounds like there's been a chain all along where you've never retired.
Well, when I was 67 at Hospice of Michigan, I'd been there 15 years, and I really had planned for my leadership transition so that I had a successor in the wings. And I think a good leader makes sure that when they leave their position, it's a non-event, that the company continues to move forward. Because if an organization falls apart after a leader leaves, they haven't done their job.
Right.
And having had the opportunity to work with the board and think through that leadership transition, I really said, okay, what do I want to do next? And I really didn't want to stop completely. I felt that I had learned a lot of lessons that I could share with boards and CEOs and executives of other companies. And so I decided that I would open up my own consulting business and formed an LLC. Had no clients, had no idea how that was going to go.
Well, you got to start somewhere.
Put up a vanilla website and got some business cards, and the rest is history. I'm now 6 years into my business, and I'm never without business. All of my business comes word of mouth from satisfied clients.
Well, obviously you must have a lot of them. Dottie, what are your views on retirement?
I think retirement is overrated. And we have stuck in our consciousness that 65 is the magic number. But when you really understand the history of the age 65, that actually goes back to the turn of the last century when Kaiser Wilhelm decided that he wanted to give benefits to veterans of the Crimea War.
Okay.
And he decided the age for that was 65. So that was the first quote-unquote Social Security that happened in Europe through Kaiser Wilhelm. At that time, only 1% of the population were 65 and older. So he was giving these benefits to a very tiny population.
Well, people didn't live very long then.
Average lifespan at the turn of the last century was 47 years of age. So
Dottie,
what has happened is in our culture is that spread from Europe to the United States, where Social Security became 65. But now we are in a century where the average lifespan is in the 80s, and many people are living in their 90s and into their hundreds. And so 65 was designed for a time when people didn't live as long. And people that are 65 today would have been like they were 50 50 years ago. And so the ability to have a higher mental capacity and health is much better in this lifetime.
You know what's interesting, Dottie, is the fact that I know some accounting firms, I don't know if it's still true now, but they used to have a mandatory retirement age of 65.
Right.
If you're in law firms too, and if, I think a lot of the big three kind of push you out too,
sure.
A lot of companies. And judges in the state of Michigan, you cannot run again if you're 70. So there's a mandatory retirement mm-hmm. age then. But it's very arbitrary. But you know, what I found in doing this show is the fact that there are a lot of people in their 70s and 80s who act like someone in their 50s. And then I know a lot of people in their 50s who are just kind of biding their time waiting to pass on. They're like someone who's in their 80s or 90s. So it's very individual. Dottie, how important is it to keep our brains active?
That is absolutely essential, is to keep challenging your brain by learning new things. And it's okay to retire. I wanted to retire from a CEO job because I did not want to be working 80 hours a week, and I didn't want to get 300 emails a day, and I didn't want to worry about 2,000 patients a day and the care that they were getting, and all of the things that go on with the pressure of running a large company. But I still wanted to give back, and I still felt that I had a lot to give. So what I'm saying in failing retirement is, how do you repot? How do you move yourself and use your gifts and your talents and still give back in a generative way so that you're not stagnating and you really are able to move forward and contribute, but not have necessarily the same pressure of the job that you had earlier in your career.
Tell us about the word you coined, which is generativity versus stagnation.
Well, that actually comes from Erikson, who looked at psychosocial development of human beings across the lifespan. And I think your reader or your listeners are going to be able to see a graphic, and I'd like to speak to that a little bit. In infancy, the key challenges that an infant is learning is trust or mistrust. If they get a lot of attention and love, then they develop trust. If they don't, they develop mistrust. In early childhood, it's autonomy versus...
Let's put the graphic up.
Is it up yet? Oh, great.
Like
Autonomy versus shame and doubt. In preschool, it's being able to have initiative versus feeling guilty all the time. In the school age, it's industry, being able to accomplish a lot of things, versus feeling inferior and not having a good sense of self. In adolescence, really developing a specific identity or being really confused about who you are. So these are challenges that happen at each stage of life, and it's about a 7-year lifespan many times for each of these stages where that transition happens. In young adulthood, young adults are trying to either develop intimacy or they're becoming isolated. How do they move out and develop a social circle, or how do they become isolated?
I'm going to jump in because, you know,
okay.
You kind of raise an interesting point. Are we, because of our reliance on social media and the internet, becoming more and more disengaged and isolated?
Well, there's been some interesting studies about technology and how that can actually connect or disengage
people. It's a double-edged sword.
If you're many miles apart, being able to use a Skype or a Zoom so that you can directly conference with your loved ones can be a very powerful thing.
Absolutely.
But I know that I'm going to Chicago next week, and when I go to the airport, nobody looks up. Everybody's looking on their phones, and everybody's...
I'm at dinners where you see a family of four, and they're all on their screens, literally.
Literally. So. Well, there are some new techniques that can be used, and actually I teach those when I do my business consulting. I have a cell phone deposit box, and I make the board members and the executives put their cell phones in the cell phone deposit box, and they can take them out at the break. But unless you cannot, the you cannot multitask. Your right. brain really does not multitask the way you think you do. You're just picking up information much much less. And what I tell them is, you're paying me a lot of money to do this work with you. So if you want to get your money's worth, then we need to focus on each other and focus on the task at hand, because you're going to get the most return on your investment.
Dottie, continue with Erikson and the eight stages. I know we digress, but I thought it was important.
But let me do one final thing around the cell phone. What a lot of families can do, and I think those of us that are graying, although thank God for hair dye, those of us that are graying can actually role model for their families, is to say, okay, everybody, cell phones go into the middle of the table. When we go out to dinner with our friends, okay, everybody, cell phones go into the middle of the table. Let's respect each other and care about each other enough to actually have a real conversation with one another. So you can teach how to begin to put boundaries right. around some of that technology.
And that's so important.
Which gets to the whole issue of generativity and stagnation, which is is the next level of psychosocial development. So those of us that are 50 and older, we have choices to make. Do we continue to give, or do we just stagnate and not take any risks, not take any chances, and just kind of tread water until the grim reaper comes and takes us away? That is really a psychological decision that each elder person has to make. And what I'm recommending about happily failing retirement is, find something that you like to do that will contribute and help you feel that you are giving some of the wisdom that you have learned over these years through the School of Hard Knocks to the next generations and to others that are coming up behind you. Whether that is volunteering at an elementary school, whether that is volunteering at some kind of not-for-profit organization, whether that is getting another job. I know some executives who retired and became greeters at Target.
quite a difference.
Because they loved people. They didn't want the hassles. They wanted the social interaction.
Right.
I know some executives that became drivers, you know, of MetroCar, because again, they got to meet lots of people. They got out of the house. And it was not that challenging of a position, but at the same time, they were able to enjoy other people and have socialization. So whatever floats your boat, you should find out what you can do that will allow you to stay active and engaged.
I think a key word that I like to use, and I've seen in many of the shows that I've done, is, what is your passion? I mean, if you're passionate about what you're doing, and obviously you are, that's important. But if you're just marking time, then find a passion.
Exactly. And find your hidden talents. I mean, some people, because of the challenges of work and caregiving, do not have the chance to do something they always wanted to do. Learn how to play the piano, or learn how to speak Spanish or French. There are many adult education programs through the community colleges that are very inexpensive, where you can even take computer skills and a variety of things that you may not be comfortable with at this time, but just that feeling of discomfort is actually great for your brain. When you're challenging your brain to work something out that you haven't done before, that really keeps the brain, it's like putting oil in the crankcase of your car.
Right. Earlier we talked about Kaiser Wilhelm setting the stage as 65 being retirement age. Is there a magic number now, or, you know, whatever floats your boat?
I don't think there's a magic number. I think that every person knows when they're ready to downshift. I call it when you're cooked and ready to serve. If you're in a particular position and you feel like the Thanksgiving turkey where the red button is popped and and it's no longer fun and it's a hassle, that's okay to say, I'm done with this and I'm ready to downshift and change. The question is, what am I changing to? And how do I find those things that will feed me, feed my soul, feed my brain, but also where I'm going to be able to give back to others and feel that I am contributing and continue to have an important purpose in life.
In your new career, you're really helping people build rather than think of retirement. I mean, it sounds like what you do is try to help people maximize their potential as executives in various business entities? Okay.
I really try to help people maximize their personal potential and also the potential of their company. And I call that holistic leadership, WHOLISTIC, a whole, meaning that any company it needs to do four things, and if they're not doing all four things, they're leaving potential on the table.
Tell us about the four things.
Those four things are what I call the head, the hands, the heart, and the soul of your business. The head is all about the strategies, tactics, analytics, frameworks, principles around which you've designed your business and what you're going to go after. So it's all the thinking part of the business. The hands is all about driving to execution, getting it done, getting results, implementing what you start. Because if you don't produce results, whether you're a for-profit or not-for-profit company, you're not helping your customer, your consumer, your client, the person that is receiving.
Absolutely.
But that's only 50% of the potential.
Okay.
The rest of the potential, the heart, is all about the people that are involved in your organization or your company, and are they engaged from the boardroom to the point of service in the enterprise?
So, Dottie, motivation is a key component.
And getting them engaged and really focused on accomplishing what you're trying to accomplish for the good of the organization. And finally, the soul is about the mission, vision, and values.
Give us some examples of that.
What is the foundation of what you're trying to accomplish? GE used to have a vision of we bring good things to light. And at their heyday, their whole idea was to bring innovation to help bring light to people's worlds and make their lives more comfortable and better and more informed. Hospice of Michigan, we have a mission of relieving suffering, but the vision was to role model end-of-life care innovation in Michigan, which could be the role model for the country. If we could figure out how to take care of more people more humanely, with a higher quality of care that is more cost-effective, because there's going to be fewer resources, and if we could figure that out at Hospice of Michigan, we could lead the way for the rest of the country.
How well has that happened with Hospice of Michigan?
Hospice of Michigan is called the Harvard of hospice in the nation.
I didn't know that, so I'm learning things.
because it is the largest hospice, and it's a not-for-profit hospice. There are 150 hospices in Michigan, and Hospice of Michigan is one of those 150, but they are the largest and the most professional, in my opinion. They have an institute where they actually do research to figure out how to give better end-of-life care. They leverage technology. They're actually a virtual company.
Where are they located, headquarters?
They have a headquarters in Ann Arbor, but basically they're all over. They're serving 70 counties in Michigan.
Very impressive. And you led them for many, many years.
15 years. Yes. And the challenge really was when you have a patient and family that are in a trailer up in the woods up north with a two-track, meaning two ruts, right, back into that trailer, and they have no electricity and no running water, and someone in that trailer has an end-of-life terminal illness, and then you have someone in a mansion in Bloomfield Hills, and then you're taking care of someone else in a cardboard box under a viaduct, under a bridge. How do you make sure that those patients and families all get the same high level of care, the same compassion, logistics? How do you get supplies, medications, dressings, people into all those locations and still delivering a same high level of care? So we became a virtual company back in 2004. We leveraged technology to be able to have just-in-time inventory, direct delivery to the home, medications, ways of deploying our staff, a call system for the entire state where anyone could call us 24/7, and the nurses in that call system would have the records of those patients and know real time what had happened with them. So those are the kinds of things that Hospice of Michigan has done, which is quite unusual for most hospices, even the for-profits.
How are they doing since you left? I mean, it sounds like
they're doing very well.
Good.
They're doing very well.
So you prepared the transition very well before you
Absolutely.
Left.
If a company falls apart when the leader leaves, then they haven't done their job.
Okay, and what about planning for end of life? I know that's something you wanted to talk about as well. Let's talk a little bit about that.
We plan for everything. We plan for bat mitzvahs and bar mitzvahs and college, and we even plan for kindergarten graduation and and retirement, but we do not plan for end of life
care. I was going to say we don't, and most of us are in denial. And I think of the examples of there are so many very prominent people who've passed away, Prince, Michael Jackson, even to a lesser degree, Mickey Rooney, and many people who either left no estate plans or no instructions, and becomes a mess.
There's an old saying, denial is not a river in Egypt.
Right. That's a very good one.
But in America, we think death is an option. Death has been so separated from our regular experience of life, and it is the last great act of life, honestly. Getting people to plan is essential, because the residual damage, not only financially but emotionally, from not planning what it is that you want at the end of life can really tear a family apart.
I mean, I think the other name I was thinking about was Aretha Franklin, which hits closer to home.
Sure.
And again, dying of pancreatic cancer, knew that it was inevitable for years and really didn't plan.
Well, we all have this bubble of immortality, as Erikson would, or psychologists would say, we almost have to feel immortal in order to get up and get out every day.
Right.
But part of what I've tried to help in my career is for people to realize that they are doing a service to themselves and their families by letting their loved ones know what it is that they want at the end of life. And the best time to have that talk is around the Thanksgiving table or some kind of dinner gathering when there is no crisis. And it is a difficult talk, but at the same time, people feel so much better afterwards. There's also, Hospice of Michigan has a website called haveyouhadthetalk.com. It's all one word, and you can download a free PDF of advanced directives and a guide to help you walk through having that talk with your loved ones and putting down in writing what it is that you want. Then put it in a Ziploc bag and put it in the freezer, because that's the safest place in the house.
Yeah. I mean, I lecture a lot and have had shows about instructions. Dottie, we're down to 2 minutes. I would like you to share some thoughts with our viewers before we sign up. Perhaps some of your future goals, and perhaps a little bit more of your company, which obviously is doing well, and you created it. I mean, you should be very proud of how you're navigating, you know, these eras that we're in now.
Thank you. Thank you. My future goals, to bring as much light in the world as I can. At the end of the day, what I'm doing with companies is trying to help them be better, because that's better for them individually, it's better for their employees, and it's better for the people that they serve. I believe that work is a sacred space. I'm a healer at heart, and so I'm just trying to do healing in a way at a broader scale than I did as a nurse with a one-on-one with patients. So that's what I would like to do, is help everyone be the best that they can be, and to celebrate the uniqueness that each person brings to the table.
Dottie, you failed at retirement. How busy are you now? I had to ask that.
I'm quite busy, but I don't get 300 emails a day. And if I want to go to a movie in the middle of the day with my husband, I can do that. And if I want to pick up my granddaughters from school, from elementary school, I can do that. I have a flexibility that I never had before.
That's important. You know, Dottie, we're down to 30 seconds. If there's a final thought you want to share before we sign up, please share with myself and our viewers.
Mahatma Gandhi said, you need to become the change you wish to seek in the world. So the real journey is inside. How do I change? Not how do they change. So the question to ask is, how do I change to give back?
And we control ourselves, but we can't control others.
That's absolutely right.
That's very important. So, Dottie Deremo, I want to thank you so much for being my guest on Gracefully Greying. This has been a real treat, and you've shared a lot of information.
Well, thank you for having me. It's been a pleasure.
I appreciate it. And I want to thank you for watching Gracefully Greying.